But there was a time when, particularly on the continent, it seemed as if the majority of motorists would have by now gone for the small car. However, in actual fact, this hasn't happened, and there's a surprisingly limited choice, as we hear now from Tony Bastable.
We have three at under 600 cc's. The Italian, the Japanese, and the most expensive, and in some ways perhaps the most eccentric of all, the legendary French peasants' transport, the Citroën Diane. There are two versions of this, the four with a 435cc engine, or this one. This is the Diane 6, which in fact just creeps over our limit at 602cc's. Air-cooled, four-stroke, flat twin. But it is expensive, all right. It's £97 more. Some £97 more than its next nearest rival, the little Japanese Honda. And if you wanted a Citroën Diane, it would set you back £816. But what do you get for your money? Apart from the engine, you get four full passenger doors. You get this excellent sunshine roof, which is included in the standard specification. And you get all the advantages of the rear opening fifth door at the back. The Diane 4, the smaller engine version, will set you back £65 less at what we think is still the rather high price of £751. Both models have front-wheel drive in the best French tradition of which old Maigret would have approved, but it is a body shape that seems to have been around for perhaps just a shade too long. It's been around a long time. The other familiar shape, the Honda N600 Touring. This time we're down to two doors. Again, front-wheel drive. And under the bonnet, again four-stroke, again two cylinders, again air-cooled, but this time a vertical engine with an overhead camshaft. And at 596cc's, it offers you about as much the same power as the big Citroën, but without the quaint French body roll. And because it's lighter, it qualifies as the fastest of the baby cars here today. If you want it, you can get it from the world's largest motorcycle manufacturer for £719. The Italian contender is the Fiat 126, which only appeared at the last Turin Motor Show and is still therefore a reasonable rarity on English roads, so we'll take a deeper drive-in look at this one. What it is basically is a replacement over here for the dear old Italian clockwork mouse, the Fiat 500, which is finishing after a heroic 17-year production run. But don't get the idea from the glamorous exterior that it's all that different under the skin. It's still rear-wheel drive, unlike its bigger brothers, the 127 and the 128. At the back, a similar mechanical layout, although they've managed to squeeze in a larger engine at 594cc's. Again, it's twin cylinder, again, it's air-cooled, and all, apart from the 20% extra in engine displacement, they've managed to up the power by 28%, all apparently without sacrificing the ability to run on 95-octane petrol. But a bad mark for this. This piece of bent wire is the dipstick, and the problem is with it is where it lives. Down there, right next to the exhaust manifold. And getting it out can be a slightly burning experience. You can easily burn your hands in that area, as I know to my cost. The Fiat 126 is very much a rebodied Fiat 500, but at first sight it looks much bigger than its predecessor. In fact, it isn't. It's only 3 inches longer and 2.5 inches wider. But what this means is that the 126 really will carry four people, unlike the old 500 in which you've just squeezed in two people and a dog. Some dog. It's very easy, of course, on any people's car to criticise it for being a bit on the austere side. And I suppose for £698, it would be a bit much to expect the sophistication of, say, a dipping mirror or a glove box. Though, to be fair to Fiat, they do give you very useful Bic bins in the sides of the doors here, and a little tray in the centre console, which I assume is for the inevitable Italian sunglasses. But there are criticisms. Criticism number one is the lighting controls. At the moment, this is what happens. You're given this switch on the dashboard, which simply switches the lights on or off. There they are, on. The condition of the lights is determined by this stalk lever. Side light, dip. Main beam at the bottom. Now, if you're driving along a road on main beam and you want to change to dip, it's far too easy to do this, to override dip altogether and plunge yourself, if it's a dark road, into almost complete darkness by going straight over to side lights. The whole problem could be cured if they turned that from a two position switch into a three position one, switching the lights on to side light and using this stalk only for dip or for main beam. Another criticism is the positioning of the choke and the starter down here just behind the gear stick in between the seats. It's archaic, it's fiddly, and it could be a little bit dangerous if you've got a handbag strap caught round it or even a trouser turn up. They have done something about the pedals. They've repositioned the pedals and they've made them a lot better than the old impossible arcs of the Fiat 500. But they still do take a lot of getting used to, and once again, here's another car where there is nowhere to rest the clutch foot, Fiat, please note. Anyway, let's see how the 126 goes. On the move, the worst feature has to be brakes. Don't get me wrong, they're always there all right, but you really have to stand on the pedal, using a pedal pressure which might prove difficult for some women drivers. In fact, none of the drive-in road test team can remember having to press so hard to stop such a small car ever before. Maybe with so many small cars having servo assistance these days, ones get spoiled. But still, lots of good news too. It's economical all right, and 51.34 miles to the gallon average. Then the road holding, some fore and aft choppiness in the suspension, but round the corners, no roll at all. Outstandingly good, super safe in fact. While the other joy is its parkability, as with all baby cars, fantastic. You're able to use parking spaces you wouldn't even have considered before. And finally, Fiat 500 fans will notice the disappearance of the old standard equipment sunshine roof. Part of its charm, I would have thought. But at least they have moved the petrol tank into a much less vulnerable position, from up the front there, down here to the side. Of course, there are lots of other baby car types. There's the Chrysler Imp, the DAF 33, the British Leyland Mini 850, which is still going strong. And in this country, if you're buying a small car as your one and only or as a second car for the wife, it really has to be a choice between the Imp or the British Leyland Mini. And the reason is that, give or take £10 or so, the price works out at much the same as the smaller, but very much slower, Fiat 126. In any case, it's a very difficult choice, and like most difficult choices, a very personal one too.